Let's touch base with the management of CG Electricals to understand what has led to the strong performance in the quarter gone by. They've been performing quite well compared to their peers. The market share gain has been phenomenal, especially in the fans and pumps business. And the 5 years in consumer durables is something that we would like to talk about, how the journey has played out. We have the management joining us right here on ET Now, Matthew Jopp, the Chief Executive Officer at Crompton Greaves Consumer Electricals. Matthew, thank you so much for taking time out. The company has managed to outperform its peers. Talk to us about how the demand has been, especially in the months of October and November. How far would you say you are from pre-COVID levels?
Just if I look back, let's focus on quarter two first, and I will give you some numbers relative to that. Then you will be able to better, understand the demand situation. While in quarter two, our results and those of many of our competitors has been, I would say, fairly strong. If I look at the market data, now for market data, we have third-party retail audit data, primarily in fans and in lighting. If I look at the third-party, retail offtake data, and I compare quarter two versus quarter one, of course, it is significantly better. In quarter one, we had seen demand drop down to almost 50% of last year level, primarily driven by the fact that we had significant lockdown. But if I look at quarter two, while it is significantly better than quarter one in terms of retail consumer offtake, if I compare with the same quarter last year, especially in fans, we see that the market demand as a total has been actually lower than last year. While, of course, as I mentioned, it is significantly better than the preceding quarter. It is true that many of the leading companies have declared good, strong results. But I don't think you should, we should automatically assume that the demand is back where it should be. In fact, I would argue that a lot of the better performance of the leading competitors can also be attributed in part to the fact that some of the weaker, smaller competitors have had significant problems because of number one, unreliable supply chain, and number two, because of not such a strong balance sheet. So these two actually allowed the leading companies in the space to do pretty well, even though I would say the market demand is still showing lower than last year. And if I were to say quarter three obviously is very early because it's still, we have not yet reached the half of the quarter. I would say that demand scenario overall as a market is similar to last quarter. I would say not anywhere near normative levels yet. But of course, there has been an improvement, sequentially, as we have seen during the last quarter. But definitely not at, pre-COVID kind of growth levels at all. The market as a whole, I would say, is still not where it should be.
You've also witnessed strong sales in core categories, fans, pumps. These are the items and products where you've gained market share as well. Do you think this kind of a growth that you've seen in the recent past is sustainable?
See, it would be very difficult, as I mentioned, to say, how much is due to pent-up demand. But I think it is, like I mentioned, the market demand of the total is still lower than where it was last year. So one cannot say that there is a lot of pent-up demand and that has actually led to strong performance. As I mentioned, the strong performance is more due to, number one, of course, superior execution capabilities and stronger balance sheet and supply chains of the stronger players, and the fact that the weaker ones had a problem. So I don't think it is due to any large-scale pent-up demand. And as since the lockdown has been lifted or partially lifted in phases, it's almost been 4 or 5 months now. So I don't think that any pent-up demand is going to last that long. In terms of, market demand going back to where it would be pre-COVID, I think that's still going to take a little bit of time. How much time exactly is difficult to say. That's on one side. But I think the market share gains that we have had in the last quarter, it's not been a one-off event. And if I look at fans and lighting over the last 3 to 4 years, we have consistently been gaining share, and it is not a one quarter event. So I would expect that the kind of programs that we have been implementing and that have delivered results all these years will continue to deliver also in the period going forward.
With home appliances being the hot favorite for consumers, will you be now focused on scaling up large categories like geysers, coolers, or perhaps mixer grinders?
Yeah, I think, if I look at our own appliances business, I would say that the appliances business has been registering strong growth in the last 6 quarters or so. So again, I want to point out the fact that it did not start in the quarter in Q2. It started much before in terms of our own in terms of our own performance. If I look at the three lead categories which you spoke about, one is water heaters, second is air coolers, and then third is mixer grinders. The water heaters, we have been clocking, I would say, around 40 to 50% growth, year on year now for the last six quarters or so. And we have strengthened our position from being, say, number five, number six in water heaters to being number two, number three. So that is a journey we started almost 6 to 8 quarters ago. And obviously, it has continued through the last two quarters, except in quarter one, where, of course, there was complete, disruption. But even in the last quarter, quarter two, that trend has continued to play out. And of course, if I look at mixer grinders, we have almost, when we spoke about appliances as a company, we've always said that our first, first focus was in water heaters to get that to top two, so that we are almost there in terms of getting that to top two. In air coolers, we are still small, but delivering industry leading growth. So that there is still a long way to go before we can say that we can get to number two, number three. But, we have been doubling our business in the last 2 years, also in air coolers. In mixer grinders, the journey, I would say, started only about 6 months ago. So we have revamped or are in the process of revamping the entire range. So that is getting us disproportionate growth. You're right. I think the market demand for small appliances, especially kitchen appliances used for cooking, has been pretty robust. In spite of the fact that on the supply chain side, there has been some level of disruption because of labor supply constraints, I think our program in mixer grinders has really started to yield results in the last 6 months or so. And we expect that we can continue, on that momentum. Because in all said and done, in mixer grinders, we are still a very small player. So I think, there is still a tremendous, opportunities ahead in terms for us to develop that business. So I would say in the quarters ahead, just like we have delivered in the last few quarters, our appliances business should continue to stay pretty strong.
Give us some color on how the rural, the semi-urban areas are shaping up in terms of demand and the categories that you've seen a good recovery in.
Yeah, just, if I look at the perspective of our own business, I would say we are still have very limited exposure in the real rural market. So when we say rural, we are still talking about, for companies like ours, still semi-urban. I'm talking about towns with population 50,000 and above. In the initial period of the pandemic, I think the big disruption happened in the main cities, in the metros and the mini metros, because that is where the disease initially, spread quickly. So the initial disruption was in the top cities, metros and mini metros. So that's where we found the initial demand drip drastically. And if I look at our own data, it's very clear that in the regions, for example, where we had the biggest disruption, for example, in western region, where Maharashtra had a significant period of disruption, which stayed pretty long, covering all the main cities like Mumbai, Pune, etc. The disruption in Q1 was much more marked and much more a deep disruption. But slowly, as the disease started spreading across the country, that disruption or the sharp difference in disruption between the big cities and the smaller cities started to reduce. And then, if I look at the last quarter, I think that the nature of demand, whether it was improving or stagnant or even going down, was very similar in all town classes. So in the last quarter, we did not see any significant difference in terms of the demand between the bigger markets and the smaller ones. But I want to point out that I'm not talking about real rural yet, because we, as a business, we don't have that much of exposure yet to rural markets.
You've already spent half a decade in the consumer durable space. Talk to us about what lies ahead. What is the strategy going to be like? What are the innovations that you're working on? And how do you see growth shaping up over the next 5 years?
Yeah, sure. I think, as I mentioned, the last 5 years, we are just a five-year-old company. But keep in mind that it's an 85-year-old brand. So I think just to give you a perspective, what has been done and then how that will play out in the future. When the company started as an independent entity about 5 years ago, I think the key thing was, the key thing to keep in mind was it was already a fairly successful business. But what had happened in the few years prior to the demerger was that the business was substantially underinvested in. So what I would say is the company was the brand had started to lose its connect a little bit with the, especially with the younger age group. Second, we were faced with a new set of nimble, more aggressive competitors. So it was very clear to us at that point of time that what had got us there, you know, would not be good enough to take us on the next phase of our journey. You're right. We had fantastic results over the last 5 years. I think So if I say what got us here, that's very important to keep in mind. I think we primarily focused on five areas, and these will also remain relevant for the next 5 years. And I will explain what more can be done there. I would say five themes which we have been talking about regularly, which has underpinned or delivered the success that we have had so far. Number one, as I mentioned, is brand. As I mentioned, Crompton is an 85-year-old brand. A brand which is known for reliability and trust, and has got a good equity, especially with the older age group. So if you look at the age group beyond, say, 40, 45, in that 40 to 50 to 60 age group, I think the brand was reasonably strong. Although even there, it had started to weaken a little bit because brand was underinvested in. But if you look at the younger age group, 25 to 40, who are today's and tomorrow's consumers, the brand connect was much weaker. You know, they did not have the same connect with the Crompton brand as a slightly older age group. So one of the things we did, we focused on quite a bit in these 5 years, is to start investing much more on the brand. If you look at our more aggressive competitors, they were investing anywhere between 2 to 3% of their revenue in advertising. Okay, and that's something which, for Crompton, that number was closer to 0.5% to 1% before the demerger. So first thing was to step up the investment in the brand. And number two was to try to build a connect with the younger age group, which is what we try to do with this whole new positioning of Crompton makes your brand, Crompton makes your home a better hangout. And as the brand building exercise is a long drawn exercise. It's going to take 5 to 10 years of consistent investment to really build a strong connect with your target population. So we have done that over the last 5 years. And if I measure the impact of that on our brand parameters, brand equity, brand awareness, all the way through the purchase funnel, it has started yielding results. So that's number one. The need to keep that going for the next 5 years as well. Continue to invest in the brand to build, Crompton as the most preferred brand in the consumer electricals industry. Number two, I say, is innovation. Okay, innovation is something, when you think of Crompton, you think of a company which is strong in engineering, strong in technology. But I think what we have tried to strengthen in these 5 years is what I call the consumer angle. So try to bring the consumer at the heart of the innovation journey. Try to understand the consumer better than anybody else. And once you understand the consumer and his pain points, then to apply our technology and engineering to be able to deliver solutions that address those pain points in a superior way. So if I look at the examples like anti-dust fans, the anti-back bulbs, the coolers that cool better, all these are examples of addressing a relevant consumer pain point, by using our technology and capability. So that's something which is, again, as I mentioned, we are only at the beginning of the journey, and that's something which has given us tremendous success, and which we will double down on in the next 5 years as well. Number three is what I call go-to-market excellence. That is what I'm saying in go-to-market excellence is to make our products available whenever and wherever our consumer and shopper wants to buy them. So just for perspective, even in fans, where we are market leaders, 5 years ago, our products were available only in 40% of stores. Now that has grown from 40% to 55%. Earlier, we were number three in terms of distribution reach 5 years ago. Today, we are number one in distribution reach in fans. In lighting, we were only 10% availability. Now we have reached 30 to 35% availability. Helped us move from number five in lighting to number two, number three. But the fact remains that in fans, for example, there are still 40% stores, 40 to 45% stores which don't have Crompton. In lighting, there are 70% stores which don't have Crompton. If I look at appliances, the mixer grinders, the geysers, there are a lot of stores. In pumps, there are still stores which don't have the Crompton brand. So the journey has got to continue. And it has taken us 5 years to move from 40% to 55% in fans, and to move from 10% to 30% in lighting, and to reach closer to 80%, which is what the market leaders need to have. There is still a lot of work to be done. And I'm still talking of real urban areas. Number four is operational excellence. You spoke about our excellent profitability, the fact that we have become the most profitable company in the industry. A lot of it has been down to the fact that we have saved an enormous amount of costs. Almost 600 to 700 crores of costs, non-value added costs, is what we have eliminated from the system. Every year, we continue to deliver about 100 to 150 crore savings on terms of cost. And that's something which we are confident we can continue to do in the years as we go ahead. You know, then in making, you know, connecting our entire company end to end, from our suppliers on one end to the company and then to our customers on the other end, to use that data to drive our business. That's something which is going to be in great focus in the next 5 years. In the last 5 years, we have spent the time putting the data infrastructure in place. But now the time has come to really use that and mine that data, convert that into information to really drive business improvements. That's something which is going to be on focus in the next 5 years. Building organization capability, you know, implementing all these improved programs required us to improve our organization capability in the last 5 years through training, development, hiring, and so on and so forth. And that's something that will continue. If you ask me what new areas we will focus on in the next 5 years, on top of, you know, carrying forward the good work that we have done so far, you know, just you raised a point in terms of rural and semi-rural. As I mentioned, most of our business today is only coming in the urban areas. And the rural economies are growing. Their disposable incomes are growing. You know, their aspirations are growing. So I think there exists a tremendous opportunity, you know, to start to move more semi-rural, rural. So a kind of a channel approach, which will make our products available to our consumers in those markets, is one key growth area. You know, you will see that digital and e-com, that whole channel, you know, especially which has even been accelerated through the pandemic, you know, digital channels, how do we get our due share there? There could be, you know, the other area where people always talk about is new segments. You know, in the last 5 years, we have spent most of our effort in consolidating the core, okay, and in also growing segments that we are already in, where we were not very strong, for example, lighting, for example, water heaters, mixer grinders. While that will continue, we also think that it is important for us, you know, for our growth ambitions for the next 5 years, to get into some allied spaces. So that's another area where we are looking at very seriously to make some, as I mentioned, as we have mentioned many times in the past, we want to get into new segments with the objective of getting a sizable share. So if I'm not able to become number two, number three, or at least get 10% share in the next 5 years, we would not get into those kind of segments. But you know, the few that we will pick and choose, we will definitely get in with an ambition of getting there 10% kind of share, at least in the next 5 years. So those are additional areas on top of the ones that we are already doing, which I think will be able to keep our growth momentum going forward.
So tell us, how much is the margin expansion sustainable given ad spends that have been restored and they're now coming back to normalcy? What is the expected margin for the second half of FY21?
See, obviously, we don't want to give, you know, any forward guidance. But I would suffice to say, if I look at quarter two, obviously, the margins have gone up, not only for us, but for many of our competitors. And I think that has come out of a few areas. You know, one is, I would say, cost reduction. And cost reduction, I would separate out into two buckets. One is one-off cost reduction. You know, things like you mentioned, cut in advertising spends because it did not make, you know, sense in advertising in Q1. Which actually for us is a high quarter. So we did not advertise in Q1 because, you know, demand was anyway not going to be there. So those kind of, and second one is, you know, more like we did, and most companies did. You know, normally the increments, salary increases for employees are given with effect from 1st of April. That we did only from 1st of October this year. So that was a one-off saving because from 1st of October, we are given the normal increment. So that, and advertising has started to come back. Even in Q2, for example, we did, you know, bring advertising back to the same level as last year. So I would say part of the improvements we saw in Q2 are one-off. However, you know, the other one that I mentioned in terms of this kind of 100 crores or 120 crores, 2 to 3% of our revenue, cost saving every year, what we have delivered so far, you know, we want to keep doing that. You know, the only difference is part of that we will, you know, in the past, we have tried to do, you know, we have tried to put part of that investing behind our brand, investing behind growth, and part of that has come to the bottom line. One needs to keep in mind as we start exploring new segments, getting into new growth areas, for example, e-com and rural, where we have not been very active in the past. As we start to get into those new areas, new business segments, new product segments, new markets, new channels, that will call for a greater level of investment. So one could really think that a bigger part of the saving that we generate will actually go into supporting some of these new growth areas compared to what we have done in the past. So that is what I would say. I would say roughly half of the margin expansion we got last quarter was because of one-off cost cost cuts. Those would not be available in the quarters to come.